There is a fifth dimension beyond that which is known to man. It is a dimension as vast as space and as timeless as infinity. It is the middle ground between light and shadow, between science and superstition, and it lies between the pit of man's fears and the summit of his knowledge. This is the dimension of imagination. It is an area which we call the Twilight Zone.
Hello and welcome to the Catholic Twilight Zone. This is Christopher from Defeat Modernism. And tonight I have a very interesting video on the poor souls in purgatory, accounts of souls returning from purgatory, according to saints and priests and individuals, to beg for prayers and to give warnings from the grave as well. Me personally, only experience that I've had thus far in my life was last year, and that would have been 2021. As some of you may know, my father had passed away in December of last year, a few days before Christmas. And in February or March of that year, I had a dream. And in the dream, his deceased mother had appeared to me. I'd never seen her in a dream before. Sadly, I don't think I ever even really prayed for her eternal rest because she had passed away so many decades ago. But in the dream, I saw her floating, and she said, "I will be seeing your father soon." And that was it. And it really struck me because it was so, it just had a huge impact on me because I had never seen anything like that before in my dreams. And I've had dreams in the past about different things that ended up being events that actually happened in the past. I actually had a dream when I was at a monastery on a retreat, and I had been praying for women who had been raped and had an abortion. And I had seen a female friend of mine in this dream, and it was all images and horrible images and things that were very strange. But I knew it had I knew it meant something because it was just so powerful and so distinct and so surreal. And it troubled me so much that on the way home from the retreat, when I got home, I called her and I told her about what I saw. And she had admitted that she had been raped and had an abortion. So anyway, so I told my father about the dream, told my mother, I told my brother. And then, sure enough, as I mentioned later that year, late last year, he had passed away. So that is my own personal story. Tonight, I'm going to start off with a story, a true story, about a man who Saint Stanislaus had raised from the dead. And then I'm going to go into a few other things, but let's just start with that now. Now, the following is taken from a book published in 1920, written by a Father Shoup, called Purgatory, illustrated by the lives and legends of the saints, and it was adapted by Mr. Hugh O'Reilly. Peter Miles, raised from the dead by Saint Stanislaus of Krakow, Poland, preferred to return to purgatory rather than to live again upon earth. The celebrated miracle of this resurrection happened in the year 1070 and is related in the Acta Sanctorum on May 7th. Saint Stanislaus was Bishop of Krakow when the Duke Boleslaw II governed Poland from 1058 to 1079. He did not neglect to remind this prince of his duties, who scandalously violated them before all his people. Boleslaw was irritated by the holy admonishment of the prelate. In revenge, he incited against him the heirs of a certain Peter Miles, who had died 3 years before, after having sold a piece of ground to the church in Krakow. The heirs accused the saint of having usurped the ground without having paid the owner. Stanislaus declared that he had paid for the land. However, since the witness, who should have defended him, had been either bribed or intimidated, he was denounced as an usurper of that property and condemned to make restitution. Then, seeing that he had nothing to expect from human justice, Saint Stanislaus raised his heart to God and received a sudden inspiration. He asked for a delay of 3 days in court, promising to make Peter Miles appear in person so that he might testify to the legal purchase and payment of the property. The days were granted to him in scorn. The saint fasted, watched, and prayed God to take up the defense of his cause. The third day, after having celebrated Holy Mass, he went out accompanied by his clergy and many of the faithful to the place where Peter Miles had been interred. On his order, the grave was opened. It contained nothing but bones. He touched them with his crozier, and then in the name of Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, he commanded the dead man to arise. Suddenly the bones became reunited, were covered with flesh, and in sight of the stupefied people, the dead man was seen to take the bishop by the hand and walk towards the tribunal. Duke Boleslaw, with his court and an immense crowd of people, were awaiting the result with the most lively expectation. "Behold Peter," said the saint to Boleslaw. "He comes, prince, to give testimony before you. Interrogate him. He will answer you." It is impossible to depict the stupefaction of the duke, his counselors, and of the whole concourse of people. Peter affirmed that he had been paid for the ground. Then, turning toward his heirs, he reproached them for having accused the pious prelate against all rights of justice. Then he exhorted them to do penance for so grievous a sin. Thus it was that iniquity, which believed itself already sure of success, was confounded. Wishing to complete this great miracle for the glory of God, Stanislaus proposed to the deceased that, if he desired to live a few years longer, he would obtain for him this favor from God, for whom nothing is impossible. Peter replied that he had no such desire. He was in purgatory, but he would rather return there immediately and endure its pains than expose himself to damnation in this terrestrial life. He entreated the saint only to beg of God to shorten the time of his sufferings, that he might the sooner enter the abode of the blessed. After that, accompanied by the bishop and a vast multitude, Peter returned to his grave, laid himself down, his body fell to pieces, and his bones resumed the same state in which they had first been found. We have reason to believe that the saint soon obtained the deliverance of his soul from the sufferings of purgatory. What is the most remarkable in this example is that a man's soul from purgatory, after having experienced the most excruciating torments, prefers that state of suffering to the life of this world. The reason which he gives for this preference is that in this mortal life, we are exposed to the danger of being lost and incurring eternal damnation. Years later, Saint Stanislaus would excommunicate Boleslaw, and the king would murder him, would kill him as he was celebrating Mass. And you would think, after seeing that, this king would have repented and changed his life. But so goes the life of the wicked. In this next section of the video, I'm going to turn it over to Father Hugo of the Society of St. Pius X Marian Corps. And in this sermon, he goes over many stories about apparitions, ghosts in Gettysburg, souls in purgatory, touching their hand to objects and burning them. These are things you can see in the Purgatory Museum. As those of you watching on video, you're seeing just some video from that museum in Rome. I'll put more pictures up as Father's speaking, but he goes into a lot of amazing accounts from priests and from holy souls from the past. So let's listen up.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. A few considerations on this day of All Souls, where Mother Church pours out many prayers by granting plenary indulgences for these first 8 days to go to the cemetery to pray. You can say any prayers, but add the Our Father, Hail Mary, Glory Be for the Pope. And then on that day, if you receive Holy Communion, confession 8 days before or after, and do this for the souls in purgatory, you can obtain for them a plenary indulgence for these 8 days. So even throughout November, try to visit the cemetery to pray for the souls there. How many are abandoned there, completely forgotten? Their tombs are overgrown with green algae or like old grass, and some of them are so disfigured you can't read them anymore, yet their souls are in purgatory and are just forgotten. So it's a great work of mercy. Remember how our Lord says, what you do to the least of these, you do to me. Well, it's not just here on earth, but also those in purgatory, the least in purgatory, some of the most forgotten, some of the most greatest sinners who might have just converted just by the skin of their teeth, save their soul. So Our Lady of Fatima even told us, an 18-year-old girl in Fatima, who when the Lucia asked, what about Emilia? The Virgin Mary said she's in purgatory till the end of the world. Now this is 1917, so long before bad fashions, long before internet, Hollywood, rock and roll music and all that, that takes so many to the worldly ways and even on a path to hell. So why purgatory? It really is a tremendous mercy of God. If there was no purgatory, no one would make it, hardly. But purgatory just shows the goodness and mercy of God, that he's all love and mercy, but he's also just. And purgatory is for those souls who die in the state of grace. But when they die, they have many venial sins, imperfections, faults, selfishness, maybe a burning love of God that they should have had. And they may also have temporal punishment due to mortal sins that have been confessed and they are truly sorry for, but they still have to make up the justice in purgatory. And the justice is not at all what Vatican II Church tries to lie to us. That Vatican II Church, the proof it's from hell, is its lie, the lies of it, and heresies and errors. But one of the big lies is, Father Bob has the Mass for Grandpa. Grandpa died, he lived a long life, and Father Bob in the local community church, wearing white vestments, gives a sermon telling everybody, well, this is Alleluia Mass because Grandpa's in heaven. He's in heaven, he's happier than all of us, and he's in a better place than all of us. Well, we hope that is the case for Grandpa. We sure do. But the realistic side of things is Grandpa probably, if he saved his soul and he had the sacraments and he died repentant, he's probably got a long time to do in purgatory. Even saints have had to spend years, months, hours in purgatory. So, what do they suffer? They suffer unbelievable pain. Some pains are very different from others. Some souls in purgatory, their purgatory is to walk on earth where they died or where they lived, just to walk and once in a while be able to ask for prayers. So that's why on the battlefields of Gettysburg and many other battlefields of the Civil War and then of other wars, you'll see ghosts. People will describe ghosts walking along the battlefield, whole troops of soldiers marching along, but they're all ghosts. And that's their purgatory. So others burn ferociously. Many souls have come back from purgatory and touched tables, touched doors, touched deep, thick wooden beams, and just at a touch, they burn their hand or the symbol, like the cross. One priest traced a cross and a board on a table, and it's deep. So how hot must something be burning to, at a touch, make it black and a deep imprint, especially a hand? They have to be burning, I would guess, and I'm no, Joe chemist but I would guess at least 450 degrees Fahrenheit, at least. And you ladies know when you iron, you had a touch, put it on as hot as you can, you don't burn something just at a touch. But in the Purgatory Museum, there's books like this where nuns have come back to other sisters, just touch the book asking for prayers, and their fingerprints are burnt right through 10, 20, 30 pages, hot. So it's no joke. And then some places they're freezing. They're ice cold freezing, like tonight outside. So let's look at a few stories from the saints, from the lives of many souls who have actually seen souls of purgatory. And among these is the great Padre Pio. Padre Pio, when talking about the souls in purgatory, he always insisted on three things. One, the importance of the sacrifice of the Mass to be offered for their souls. There's nothing more powerful than the heart of Jesus, his precious blood, his sacred face dripping with blood, his five wounds offered to the Father. That's what the Mass is. So when the Mass is offered for them, it deletes an enormous amount of their purgatory. Enormous amount. And sometimes we know the 30-day Masses often release them from purgatory. So one, the power of the Mass. Two, this is interesting what Padre Pio says. Wouldn't he know? He talked to many souls in purgatory. He says the deceased still live spiritually among us and have not left us at all. So our relatives and friends and those you think of, they're actually thinking of more of you than you do of them. So they're actually among their friends and family more than we even realize. And sometimes they manifest themselves. And then last, the importance of resignation to God's will on the death of a loved one. Because this is extremely efficacious for the release of their soul from purgatory. So to be resigned, that if God takes a soul, be at peace with that it was God's time. And that just that resignation can release them from purgatory. And St. Francis de Sales says another powerful thing is forgiving. Forgiveness of past injuries and damage done to you, your character, your property, just forgiving all that can release souls from purgatory. And St. Francis de Sales gives the famous example of the college boys running down the street, shooting down some of the empty alleys. And one kid shot a boy. And he shot him dead by accident. And panicking, he ran to a house of this woman, and she was a widow. And he said, "Hide me, hide me. They're looking for me, the police." And the police came to her door. And the police said, "We're looking for this guy who was shooting down the alleys. These are in the streets of Padua. So you got those medieval streets." So they would have had fun hearing the bullets ricochet down the alleys. Well, the mother, it turns out the woman who took the young man, the college boy, in, was the mother of the boy he killed. And the mother, right then on the spot, told the police, "Go easy on this young man. I forgive him. I forgive him for shooting my son. I forgive him." And at that moment, says St. Francis de Sales, she saw a vision of the son, her boy, who was in purgatory, immediately be released from the flames and go straight to heaven. Why? Because she forgave. So that's the power of charity. So many of the saints went into purgatory. Many of the saints spoke with souls in purgatory, saw their suffering, and they understand. And when the saints tell us, pray for them, they need it. It's true. And of course, the scripture's authority, the Book of Maccabees says it is a holy and wholesome thought to pray for the dead, that they may be loosed from their sins. Oh, but the Protestants say, "Oh, but it doesn't say purgatory. Show me where it says purgatory in the Bible." Well, it doesn't. But to pray that for the dead, that they might be loosed from their sins, is purgatory. It's not hell because they can never be loosed from their sins. It's certainly not heaven because they have no sins to be loosed from. So where is this place that they need prayers that they can be loosed from their sins? It's purgatory. But it's not, the word purgatory is not in the Bible. Just like the word Most Holy Trinity, we believe in the Holy Trinity, but it's not, Most Holy Trinity is not in the Bible, those words. But Christ says, "Go baptize in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost." That's the three persons of the Holy Trinity, for example. So let's look at a few of the lives of the saints. Padre Pio. He once was talking with his brothers during recreation, and then he got up and he went into the hallway and he started talking with people that none of the brothers could see anybody. But there was Padre Pio laughing and smiling and giving his blessing and greeting people. So the brothers thought, maybe Padre Pio's going crazy. Maybe those five wounds are getting to his head. And Padre Pio came back in and they said, "Why were you talking to yourself in the hallway?" He says, "I wasn't. You didn't see them?" He says, "These were all these souls, a whole group of them came to thank me for Mass that morning, remembering them at Mass that morning. They were thanking me because they were on their way from purgatory to heaven." Padre Pio described one such incident that during World War I, there occurred at the friary in San Giovanni Rotondo, that was the monastery where they lived. He had been sitting alone in a guest room, absorbed in prayer one night, when an old man walked in and sat next to him. I looked at him, but never thought of how he had managed to get in the friary at that hour. So I asked him, "Who are you? What do you want?" The man answered, "Padre Pio, I am Pietro Di Marro, nicknamed Prococo. I died in this friary on September 18th, 1908." 1908. This is long before this building was a monastery. "I died in room number 4. When this friary was still a home for the elderly. Now, Franciscans call their monastery a convent or a friary. So that's why it's being called a friary. So he says, I died in room 4 when it was a home for the elderly back in 1908. And he said, when I was in bed one night, I fell asleep with my cigar burning. My bed caught fire and I died. I suffocated and burned alive. I am still in purgatory and I need a mass to free my soul from it. God has given me permission to come to you and ask you for your prayers. After I had listened to his story, I said, this is Padre Pio speaking, you can rest assured that I will celebrate Mass tomorrow for your liberation. Padre Pio related that the Mass he offered the next day freed the man's soul from purgatory. One of the other priests of the friary, one of the other Franciscans, later on checked the village records in the archives and found that such an individual, Pietro di Maro, had indeed died under the circumstances he described to Padre Pio. So Padre Pio, of course, was a very good friend of the souls in purgatory. Another story is told from a priest in Germany. The following story, showing the interest taken by the holy souls in those whom they loved on earth, was related by Father Schroeder in a sermon he preached in the cathedral at Munich. And he said that he had the details from the priest to whom it happened. So I bring this story to show that we often think of the souls in purgatory. We do know they need our prayers, but do they help us? Do they actually help us? And in that very great book called Purgatory by Father F.X. Schupp, a Jesuit, he has many stories of how the souls in purgatory do help us. And I think it was a brother or a priest who would always go to the cemetery and pray for the souls in purgatory. And one day a bunch of thugs surrounded him to beat him up. And then there rose up all these souls from purgatory in his defense. And they shielded this holy monk from being beat up by these thugs. So the souls do help us. And here's another example of a good mother who died. Late on a stormy evening, a priest of one of the parish churches of Vienna in Austria opened the door himself on hearing a loud ring at his door. There was a lady standing there, and she entered saying she had been sent to require his immediate attendance for a man in danger of death, adding that the distance was pretty far, and begging that he would take the Holy Communion. Holy Viaticum is the last Holy Communion for the dying. As soon as the priest was ready, she accompanied him to the parish church to procure the Blessed Sacrament, and said she would go before to show him the way. The night was wild, and before they had reached their destination, a house in the suburbs, a hurricane was blowing and the snowstorm was terrific. The lady stopped, saying, "This is the gentleman's house." And she rang the bell, and the door was not opened. She did so a second time. On looking around, the priest found she was gone. Then the window was open and an elderly gentleman called out to know what was wanted. The priest answered that he had been hurriedly sent for to attend to a dying man. "There is no dying man in this house," he answered, "and no one is sick." It is quite a mistake. And he was about to close the window when, moved by a natural feeling of compassion for the poor priest, who could scarcely stand because he was freezing, he added, "But if you would like to take shelter till the storm is past, you are welcome to come in." So he opened the door and showed him into a sitting room and set his lamp down on a table, and then threw open a door at the other end of the room and disclosed a small oratory in which there was an altar, a large image of Our Blessed Lady, and a lamp burning before it, saying, "There you can deposit your burden." The priest placed the Blessed Sacrament on the altar. He lighted two candles, made his genuflection, and re-entered the room, saying, "I am sorry to have disturbed you, but at least I see the mistake has brought me to the house of a good Catholic." "There you are entirely mistaken," replied the gentleman. "I am an unbeliever, and I glory in so being. No doubt you are astonished at finding a chapel and an altar and lamp burning, but if you like, and it is impossible to attempt returning during this whirlwind, I shall explain the meaning for all this." He then told the priest that his mother, on her deathbed, had made a promise to keep that lamp burning as long as he lived, that in that oratory she had daily prayed, and that he, when a child, knelt there with her. Then he spoke eloquently in praise of his mother, told of her goodness, her piety, her love for the poor, her only fault being her attachment to the Catholic faith, which he excused as an illusion, which had done no harm to anyone and made her happy. Probably for many years he had never spoken of his mother to his own associates, but to this stranger, this priest, whom it was likely he would never see again, he poured out his whole heart and seemed to take a strange delight in recording all his mother's excellence and her love for him, how she always said, "Hans, my son, I shall never cease begging our Lord for your conversion." And when dying, she said that when in the presence of God, it would be her first prayer that he might return to the Catholic faith. The priest, well versed in the science of souls, questioned him and lured him on to talk. He told him how he had once been a good Catholic, how he had discovered that religion was all nonsense, what a life he had then led, how he had grieved his mother, for which he was very sorry, adding that the least he could do was to remain faithful to his promise and keep the lamp burning at the altar. And though he never looked at the altar, he still kept the lamp burning all these years, for she had been long dead. The young man suddenly arose, took the lamp, and said, "See, here is a portrait of my mother." And he held the light up to a large oil painting, which the priest instantly recognized as the portrait of the lady who had led him to the house. Feeling that a supernatural mystery was being enacted, he concealed his emotion and continued encouraging the young man to speak more and more. The night went on, the hurricane ceased, neither seemed to heed it, and to bring the story to a close, by 3 o'clock in the morning, the penitent was kneeling at the priest's feet, bathed in tears, making a full general confession of his whole life, and in such good dispositions that the priest gave him then and there Holy Communion at his mother's little altar. They stayed some time longer together, and before dawn the priest took leave, promising to return on the following day and pay him a visit. He kept his word, but on arriving at the house, he heard that the gentleman had died. He had been found dead in his bed that very morning. We may suppose the priest thanked God very fervently for the wonderful grace that he granted to this soul. So the souls in purgatory, do they help us? They sure do. And they do pray for us. And remember, when you, by your prayers and masses and rosaries and penances, release them, when they get home in purgatory, in heaven, they will definitely help you from heaven. And if we pass through purgatory, they will help us. And they will get all their friends in heaven to help us. And Padre Pio said, for those who are devoted to him, and most of us are, he's a priest of our time and a great, great saint and mystic. He said he will stay at the gates of heaven until he makes sure all his sons and daughters get there before him. And after they enter, he will enter. So let's ask Padre Pio to help us. And remember, let's pray generously for the souls in purgatory in this month of November. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. And may the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. But I want to impress on your minds the great truth of purgatory. Purgatory is real. Purgatory doesn't last forever, but for many souls, it will last till the end of the world. And remember the children of Fatima, when the Virgin Mary appeared to them at the first apparition, May 13th, 1917, 100 years ago. The children were, what were they, 7, 8, and 9, I think. They were very young. We got 7, 8, and 9 year olds right here, right? So they were about that age when they saw the most beautiful Virgin Mary. And in the course of the Virgin Mary said to the children, yes, you will go to heaven. And they were very happy about this. But she said, Francisco will have to say many rosaries. And then they asked about two friends. One, and she said she's in heaven already. And then another one that died probably within a year or two or three that the children knew, a friend of theirs who was probably about 18 to 20 years old, a young girl. What about Amelia? And the Virgin Mary said, she's in purgatory till the end of the world. Now, she's only, let's just say she died at age 20. But what in the world could a girl in 1917, 1916, when there was no miniskirts, no horrible internet garbage, no bad music, no corruption like we have now, what could in the world could she have done to merit to be in purgatory, not for just 20 years of her earthly life, but till all the way to the end of the world? Mystery of God's justice. But it puts a different light on how serious sin really is. And what is sin? Sin is any thought, word, action, or omission that goes against the law of God. And when we commit sin, there's levels of degrees of sin, of course, imperfections, venial sins. This is the hay, the stubble, the wood, which we also must be sorry for. And one good act of contrition washes that away, forgives it. One Holy Communion washes away venial sins. But mortal sins bring death to the soul. Mortal sin is the worst thing possible that can happen to us. Worse, it's the worst thing. If you lose your leg by amputation or a bullet wound, or you lose your eyesight, or you lose your hearing, that's okay, that's not so great, but to lose mortal sin is the worst. Excuse me, to lose the state of grace by mortal sin is the worst. And that souls who don't repent of those mortal sins go to hell. And the Virgin Mary, she appeared crying, weeping in La Salette. And at Fatima, she showed the children hell and said, pray, because so many go there because people don't pray and do penance for them. And the greatest penance we can all do is our duties of state. Just try to do it the best we can out of love for God. So let me just touch on a few examples of souls and words of saints and holy people about purgatory. Firstly, St. Catherine of Genoa. She had a great devotion to the souls in purgatory, and many of them would appear to her to ask for prayers. And she would actually converse with them. And she said this,
The greatest suffering of the souls in purgatory is the awareness that something in them displeases God, that they have deliberately gone against His great goodness. I can also see that the divine essence is so pure and light-filled, much more than we can imagine, that the soul that has but the slightest imperfection would rather throw itself into a thousand hells than appear thus before the divine presence. Hence, the soul, aware that the impediment it faces cannot be removed in any other way, hurls itself into purgatory. That is why the soul seeks to cast off any and all impediments so that it can be lifted up to God. So purgatory is a place of great suffering. And there's degrees of purgatory. Some of them are in real fire, as hot as the fires of hell. Some of them are frozen in ice. Some of them are meant to wander about on earth, where, around the place where they died, or where they lived, or where they where they sinned. And that's why on the battlefields of Gettysburg, there are many ghost stories, because those are souls of purgatory, sentenced to wander there until they're released from purgatory. It's a mystery of God's justice. And some souls in purgatory, their suffering is very intense, but as time goes, their suffering lightens and lightens and lightens, and the love of God, according to their capacity, grows and grows and grows, so that by the time they leave purgatory, they love God as perfectly as they can with the degree of charity that God gave them. And they're purified from their sins. So some saints had to spend maybe a few hours in purgatory. Some even 6 months, like Saint Severus, a bishop of Cologne in Germany, who would pray the divine office sometimes quickly and distractedly. He had to spend 6 months in purgatory for that. And then others are there for many, many years. Here's an account by Eugenie von der Leyen. On September 5th, 1925, she was a holy woman, another soul who the souls of purgatory used to come to and beg prayers. And in this case, it was a Dominican priest that she knew while on earth. On September 10th, 1925, the Dominican, she writes in her memoirs, the Dominican priest is not frightening to see, but very often he's around. September 13th, the Dominican is a father I have known well. He's a Frenchman. He was a long time with me, nodded assent when I started praying. So he was very happy when she prayed for his soul. September 17, 1925, I was very sad about something this night and cried. Then a hand was laid on my head. I looked up. It was the Dominican priest. He said, "Why do you weep?" I said, "Because I am not content with myself." He said, "Have confidence and be humble." I said, "How can I help you then?" He said, "By mortification." Then he remained for a long time. He is not scary at all. It is the first apparition that began talking unasked for. So normally they ask, many saints ask the soul of purgatory, in the name of Jesus Christ, what are you and why are you here? And out east, there are many homes that have these souls of purgatory, many, many homes of our parishioners. And I've encountered easily more than 10 cases where it was souls of purgatory wandering in their house, footsteps on the second floor, no one's there, doors being shut, things being misplaced on the tables, tools being missing and found somewhere else where the father didn't lay them, and other things like that. And these are often souls of purgatory who come to Catholic people asking for prayers. And to one of these holy souls, even some Protestant souls that were in purgatory and saved not because of Protestantism, but because they were repentant of their sins and out of God's mercy. And when they are allowed to come and ask for prayers, what do they ask for? Take a wild guess. They asked these holy Catholic people, please have a mass said for me. Because in purgatory, they know the real picture, and they know the value of the mass, and that the mass is truly not a meal and a gathering of the community and a moral presence of Jesus Christ, but the real presence of Jesus Christ, his real sacrifice, and the souls in purgatory long for this. It really relieves them and releases them and refreshes them. And that's why they always beg for masses. That's why it's important in these first days of November, and actually all through November, you should visit the cemetery and pray for the souls in purgatory. This is from the Ricolta, called the Totius Quotius Indulgence. The faithful, as often as they visit a church in order to pray for the dead on the day on which the commemoration of all the faithful departed is celebrated, November 2nd, or on the Sunday immediately following, may gain a plenary indulgence applicable only to the souls detained in purgatory on conditions of confession and communion and the recitation 6 times during each visit of the Our Father, Hail Mary, Glory Be, for the intentions of the Sovereign Pontiff. So this is either a church or a cemetery you can visit. So visit the cemetery for sure. So say 6 times the Our Father, Hail Mary, Glory Be, for the intentions of the Pope. Go to confession within 8 days before or after November 2nd. Go to Holy Communion 1 day before November 2nd or within 8 days afterwards. You may gain this plenary indulgence each time you visit a church on this day and say the above prayers, and also or visit a cemetery. So you don't want to miss out, for the poor souls, these great graces for them. Now, some more accounts. St. Bridget of Sweden, 1303, she died in 1373. She heard the souls in purgatory praying this prayer. We implore thee, they're speaking to our Lord, we implore thee for the sake of thy infinite mercy to turn away thine eyes from our innumerable sins. Imbue with thy true love the religious, the priests, and the faithful, so that they may hasten to our relief by their prayers, by their sacrifices, alms deeds, and indulgences. They can aid us if they wish. They can hasten our union with thee, O God. So the souls in purgatory suffer immensely, as we're going to see. They're really burning, burning. But they're also at peace, because they know, one, they're never now in danger of going to hell like we are. We're in danger of going to hell. We could all lose the faith or fall in mortal sin, die, and be damned forever. That's frightening. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, says St. Paul. How true that is. But in purgatory, you're out of that fear zone. You're going home. You're going home. So they're very much at peace. They are actually very happy in their soul. And they're happy to suffer whatever God requires of them to suffer, for however long they're supposed to suffer, because they know the more they're going to, as time passes, they're getting closer and closer to the beatific vision. And you read, you hear a lot and read a lot about people who have died, right? And even non-Catholics who have died, and they're in this dark tunnel, and at the end they see this light. That's very common in all these death experiences. And then they come back. Some souls hear the voice of Christ say, you never knew me on earth. I don't know you. Depart from me. And they're swallowed down into a deep hole going towards hell. And one man, in one description, he said he was a surfboarder, and he was once attacked by a shark. And the shark was grabbing his leg and pulling him down into the depth of the sea. Now that's pretty frightening, right? But he said when he was on that table and died, being sucked down this hole towards hell was far more frightening. And he was brought back to life. God gave him another chance, this man. And there's many kind of cases like this. But we know that light, that inaccessible light, as St. Paul described, And God is light of light, true God of true God, and true matter. That light is the light of the Blessed Trinity. And all of us are made, we're made to see God. And when we die, everything becomes more clear. The soul separate from the body, it's like waking up out of a dream. You know, have a dream, you remember what it is, but it's not always clear in all the details, right? And you're foggy-minded. But when you wake up, you're clear. That's what waking up death from this life is like. Everything becomes clear. Everything becomes even brighter to the eyes. And the soul knows all it wants to see is God. Because it's built into us the supreme thirst for happiness. And who alone can fill the thirsty soul but God? Who alone can feed the hungry soul? God alone. And when your soul is separated from the body, you're never hungry. You're never thirsty. Except for love. You thirst for the love, and that is the love of God. And that's why purgatory, that's the greatest suffering, says St. Catherine of Genoa, and also St. Thomas Aquinas. And of course, in hell, that is the greatest suffering. So, now let me give a few examples. In Rome, there is a museum called the Purgatory Museum. I was there once and got to see about 25 artifacts of souls who have come back on earth and touched their hand to a table, touched their hand to a door, touched their hand to, in this case, a woman's apron, or the nightcap of a man, or the shirt sleeve of a man. And in each case, just at a touch, their hand burnt right through it. Now, if you take a red-hot iron, put it on as high as you can, and touch the iron to a towel and take it off, is it going to burn a hole through it? No. So that's burning very hot. These souls are really burning, easily up to 400 to perhaps 450 degrees Fahrenheit. Here's some examples. In the Exhibit 4, there's a photocopy of burn marks that here in this book. There's a picture of it. The photocopy of burn marks left by a Benedictine choir sister named Clara Schollers. The original objects are kept in the Benedictine monastery of Winnenberg near Warendorf, Germany. This sister appeared there to Maria Herendorp, a lay sister of the monastery, on October 13, 1696. Her hands left burn marks on Maria Herendorp's apron, her apron, and also on a piece of linen. She had died of the plague in 1637, and thus she had been in purgatory for 59 years. And she touched her hand, and here's a picture here of the hand burnt marked right into her apron. And then there's other hand burn marks. And you can also see in there the books. Books of souls of purgatory that came back and touched the book, like the Imitation of Christ. They just touched it once, and their fingers burnt deep into the pages. So, and they're always asking for prayers, and especially the Mass. Here's another one. The soul of Father Panzini. He was the former abbot from Mantua, Italy. Father Panzini appeared on November the 1st, 1731, on All Souls' Day, the eve of All Souls' Day, to the Venerable Mother Isabella Fornari, the abbess of the Poor Clares of the Monastery of St. Francis in Todi. He left one mark from his left hand, plus a sign of the cross burned deeply into the wood of Mother Isabella's work table, one of the same left hand on a sheet of paper, and finally on Mother Isabella's tunic, the imprint of a burn that passed right through and also burned the sleeve of her shirt. The last one is stained with blood. It is plausible that this soul came to Mother Isabella because the intercession of holy souls has the most effect. Mother Isabella was a venerable. Father Isidoro Gazala of the Blessed Crucifix, confessor of the abbess, wrote a report of the event and ordered the abbess to cut off from her tunic and her shirt the parts bearing the mark and hand. All objects were to be handed over to him to preserve them. So here you got, you can see from your angle, the table mark, and that's in Rome. The picture of his hand that just touched the table once, his left hand, and with his right hand he carved the cross. And this is a priest in purgatory asking prayers. And I saw that table in the exhibition. And it would be great someday for modern skeptics to, you know, to allow some studies actually to be done on them. And I'll tell you why in a minute. Here's another book, Imitation of Christ, of the hand marks burnt right into the pages. And often when the souls of purgatory touch a page, it's a page that mentions praying for the souls in purgatory, remembering to turn to have masses said for them and ask the Virgin Mary to relieve them. Here's other examples of burn marks. There are 6 of them here recorded, and I'm not going to read them all, but I'll take 2 of them. The Augustinian monastery in Fuchsmühl, Germany, preserved a piece of cloth with the burn mark of a hand made during a well-documented apparition on April 4th, 1736. The night before, a woman who had died 34 years prior appeared to her daughter-in-law and asked for holy masses for the poor souls. At the second apparition, the seer, in the company of her husband and 2 other men who were in the house, asked the soul for proof of her real presence, whereupon the departed soul requested a piece of cloth, and she struck with a hard and loud blow the cloth and an imprint of her hand upon it. The 3 men, aged 56, 46, and 44 years old, testified under oath that although they had not seen the apparition, they heard it, and that they had also heard the loud blow. And they kept the mark of the burn hand on the cloth. And that's kept in Germany. The other example. The burned-in thumb in a prayer book at Hall in Tyrol, Australia. Hall is the name of the town. H-A-L-L. Is rather well known, at least to the Austrians. It was produced in 1669 by Father Christoph Walbach, who had died on May 5th, 1605. At one of his apparitions to the housekeeper of one of his successors, the deceased left this impressive sign to make it clear how terrible a fire it was he was in, because on earth he had read Holy Mass out of avarice for the money he could get. So canon law put an end to that. I guess priest could say 5 masses a day and get money for all the stipends of that mass. But that was all fixed by the Code of Canon Law. And by the Code of Canon Law of Pius X now, a priest can only say 1 mass with a stipend attached to it only once a day. So that was what this priest was saying, several masses a day, but not with the right intention, but to get more money. So out of avarice for the money he could get, also he wanted to prove that his appearance was not an illusion. He was already in purgatory for 65 years. And in a remarkable detail, he revealed that he would have to suffer for another 50 years if he were not released by prayers during that half year, granted him to ask for help. In fact, this soul of this priest had manifested himself already for a longer period through spook phenomena, that is, scratching, first blows on the wall, rapping, knocking on the walls, noises as if someone were walking through the presbytery, moaning. The presbytery is where the priest lived, the priest's house. One time, the housekeeper saw the soul of the priest in the church, dressed as a priest of former days. Although he had been noticed by her more often, he had never spoke until she mustered up her courage and asked him what he wanted. Various persons, among them the parish priest, witnessed the manifestation and heard the moaning. The thumb burn in the prayer book of that town went right through a heavy cover of wood and pigskin, and then through 40 pages, and decreasing in intensity through 30 more pages. It must have been produced during one short, intense moment, for there are no traces of burning beyond the burned-in hole. And to try to test this out, there was a blacksmith who experimented with the glowing iron thumb, but could not nearly reproduce the phenomenon himself. Instead, the whole paper burned. Likewise, artificially burned-in hands do not show the typical feature of burn marks created by the departed. So when they try to replicate this by burning pieces, it doesn't do the same thing with the precision of a soul from purgatory. So that thumb, he put his thumb right through the book. And many other apparitions of souls from purgatory who have appeared and have asked for prayers. This is the saintly Bavarian mystic, Sister Maria Anna Lindmeier. She was born in 1657 and died in 1726. She saw the souls in purgatory often, and many times how they appeared characterized the spiritual or moral state of their souls. Their features symbolized their vices as well as the kind of punishment they suffered. And here's what she says: "I have always been given to understand that how you sin, so you must do penance. Some appeared to me very hungry, emaciated, in an indescribable form. These implored me to help them by fasting severely on water and bread, to correct what was wanting in them during their lifetime by their eating and drinking well and abundantly. Others again made known by their behavior their quick-temperedness and impatience, and they implored me to help them by acts of patience and meekness. Such souls were shown to me, their mouth locked with a nail." And then here's some more accounts. There was a holy priest. His name was Father Stanislaus Papsinski. And this priest founded a congregation called of the Immaculate Conception. The Congregation of the Immaculate Conception, the so-called Marian Fathers, whose whole purpose was to pray for the souls in purgatory. And sometimes he would, in ecstasy, go down into purgatory for a long time and see the souls and speak with them. And then he would come back on earth and tell, when he was asked, "What did you see?" He said, "What they suffer is indescribable. And we must pray for them." That's all he would say. We must pray for them. And then in this book, there's a whole chapter devoted to something very interesting, which is a relic in Poland. And here is the picture. There's the box it's kept in. And there's a close-up of the corporal. And what it was two priests who lived in this shrine of Częstochowa, where the beautiful icon of the Virgin Mary is in Poland, and it's a shrine of many thousands, millions of people go there every year. So these two priests made a deal that whoever dies first, the one who died, must let the other know where they are. So this the other priest who survived, he was saying Mass. And as he was at the end of Mass, he was folding the corporal as the priests do. And there's nine folds in the corporal. And as he was folding it, the other priest appeared, just put his hand on the corporal and vanished to show him he needs prayers. And here's the description. The oldest testimony that we can find is a report of probably done in 1890 by one Father Reichel, the parish priest of Hunsfeld near Wrocław in Poland. These are his words. I was with two confreres on a pilgrimage in Częstochowa when a friar of the monastery who had the supervision of the sacristy showed us the noteworthy things. He led us also into an adjoining vault and showed us there, among other things, out of special kindness, remarking that this was done only exceptionally, a square tin box with a lid. He lifted this, and we saw lying in it a corporal on which a human hand that must have been red hot had been impressed. The upper layers of the linen were totally burned through. The lower layers were browned, increasingly more lightly. In the deeper parts between the individual joints, the fold of the linen of the linen were conserved, visible. There where the muscle are more articulate, the thicker part of the hand, the combustion was quite visibly stronger, decreasing gradually on the sides. The following had occurred. Two clerics of the monastery of the Paulinian order had promised one another many years ago that the one who would die first would give the other a sign from the beyond. Now one of them was dead already for a long time and never had given a sign. This was what the other one was thinking about when one day he had just finished Holy Mass and as usual was folding together the corporal before him in nine folds. Then the evil doubt went through his head that perhaps there would be no survival after death at all. Because he hadn't heard from him, and this priest had a doubt here against the faith. At that moment, a hand appeared, lays itself on the corporal, and immediately disappears again. How much it was ablaze through and through, however, is shown clearly enough by the combustion of the nine times folded up linen exactly in the form of the hand. So that's that priest who put his hand on the corporal. So do these souls of purgatory suffer? Yes, they do. And remember, St. John Bosco, he doesn't recommend doing that. He doesn't recommend making these deals because he made a deal with another seminarian called Camolo. And the seminarian, long story short, St. John Bosco was in the dormitory. He was in school at the time. And it sounded like a huge train was running through the building. And the huge wind burst open the front doors, and a big, powerful wind blew through the dormitory. It woke everybody up. And Camolo shouted out, "Bosco, I'm saved. Bosco, I'm saved." So St. John Bosco said it was so frightening that scared everybody out of their wits. He said he doesn't recommend doing that, making those deals. But anyway, one deal we should make is always remember the souls in purgatory. How many of you have relatives that are there? Maybe ancient relatives who you'll never know until you hopefully get to heaven. And many friends that you knew on earth. Many people who are buried in your own town here who are in purgatory. And purgatory is really out of God's mercy. It is so merciful of God. And there's another description of this holy soul. There's a soul of a man who was going to go to hell. And she knew this man. And the priest didn't know what to do with him. And he was just like a wild goat. And he once tried to shoot her grandfather. this description. But anyway, he said he was about to go to hell, but it was the Virgin Mary who snatched him from going to hell. And that soul had the chance to appear to this other soul, and he appeared all deformed at first because of his sins. He couldn't even speak. And then only after 2 months of appearing to her once in a while, he was able to speak. And he says he was in purgatory for a very long time, but he asked for prayers. But he was saved from hell because of the Virgin Mary. So how much we owe to our Blessed Mother in these days when it's so easy to go to hell, so easy to fall in mortal sin, so easy to lose our soul. And the modern world can care less. Most souls really don't care. But we got to love those souls and pray for their conversion. And we should, in this month of November, we really got to pour out prayers for the souls in purgatory. So visit a cemetery. And remember, they will help you also. There's an account of a man told by Father Jacobus Veragine. There was a man who used to go to the cemetery and pray. As he walked through the cemetery, and it was a big cemetery, he would pray the seven penitential psalms as he walked by the cemetery and through it. And he did this very often, maybe on his way to Mass. And one day, there was a bunch of thugs, thieves, a gang of thieves, who started chasing him to beat him up and get his whatever he had on his possession. So he started running through the cemetery. And what happened? The souls of purgatory rose up and defended him and drove off the thieves and scared them to death. And they took off like cats. So, and he realized his prayers for the souls in purgatory, the souls protected him. And they will. They do love us very much. And they want our prayers. And if you pray for them, they will always repay it. And when they get to heaven, they will always intercede for you. And you children, God loves the prayers of children. And you must speak to God often throughout the day. Raise your mind to God. We're so distracted by so many things. But how many of you really speak to God with your heart throughout the day? See the chickens out there? Their heads always in the ground because they're looking for worms and bugs, right? And they dig in the dirt and they look for bugs. But we're not just to be that way, looking in this world to find what fun is in this world. We're not made to be like that. Chickens are, but that's why God made them, and they never sin. But we sin if all we do is look to this earth. But we got to raise our heart to God and ask His help in the Virgin Mary. Help me be a saint. Help me get to heaven. Help me keep the faith. Help me fight for the faith in this age of apostasy. Help me to do your will. Is it to be a priest? To be a nun? Is it to be a brother? Is it to be married? But to be a saint in whatever state of life. And pray for the souls in purgatory, who are our friends on the other side. And they do suffer, as you heard, and as you saw some of the descriptions. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and that perpetual light shine upon them. And may the souls and all the souls of the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
It is a holy and wholesome thing to pray for the dead, that they may be loosed from their sins. From the book 2 Maccabees, chapter 12, verse 46.
Our Lord shed tears in seeing the tomb of Lazarus. And the Church, well acquainted with the feelings of her divine founder, is incessantly recommending charity for the souls suffering in purgatory. One of her eminent doctors, St. Thomas Aquinas, has said that, quote, of all prayers, the most meritorious, the most acceptable to God, are prayers for the dead, because they imply all the works of charity, both corporal and spiritual, end quote. But there are many people unconscious of the fact that charity for the poor souls is profitable to the living as well as to the dead. It is the teaching of the most learned theologians, St. Alphonsus Liguori, Silvius, Bellarmine, Bonacina, and Suarez, St. Alphonsus says, quote, "It is true, they are unable to pray or merit anything for themselves. Yet, when they pray for others, they are heard by God." End quote. And let us now refer to St. Robert Bellarmine. He says, quote, "The souls in purgatory can pray for those who address to them their petitions and obtain from God help, forgiveness, assistance against temptations, and all favors, both temporal and spiritual, which they may need." End quote. Many saints have experienced this wonderful assistance. St. Catherine of Bologna assured her sisters that, quote, "She obtained many favors by the prayers of the holy souls in purgatory, which she had asked in vain, through the intercession of the saints." End quote. St. Teresa affirms that, quote, "She always obtained the favors which she asked from God through the intercession of the poor souls." End quote. We read also in the book of St. Bridget's Revelations that, quote, "Being one day conducted by an angel into purgatory, she heard a soul say, 'O Lord, vouchsafe to reward those who assist us. Return hundredfold blessings to those who help us and introduce us into the light of heaven.'" End quote. St. Leonard of Port Maurice emphatically affirms that, quote, "The blessed souls, delivered by our prayers, will come down from heaven to assist us in our temporal and spiritual affairs." End quote. The Venerable Cure of Ars, replying to a priest, said, "If one knew what we may obtain from God by the intercession of the poor souls, they would not be so much abandoned. Let us pray a great deal for them. They will pray for us." St. Margaret Mary Alacoque had a special devotion to the souls in purgatory and has often accepted the charge of suffering for them. She said, quote, "Would that you knew how my soul was replenished with joy when speaking to those souls and seeing them immersed in glory as in a deep ocean. As I requested them to pray for you, they replied, 'An ungrateful soul is not to be found in heaven.'" End quote. No, we cannot be deceived. If we have an ardent charity, a sincere piety, a true devotedness for the poor souls, we will be favored with their protection. Let us try it. When we are in trouble, when we long for a favor, let us perform some pious or charitable work for the relief of the poor souls. They will be grateful. They will plead for us and present our requests to the Eternal Father who loves them. And that is from a 1931 booklet entitled The Poor Souls in Purgatory by Father J.F. Doran, who was a missionary of the Sacred Heart.
And now let's move on to the 17 Privilege and the 30 Gregorian Masses. Pope John the 22nd, in his bull, Sacratissimo Uti Culmine, after Our Lady appeared to St. Simon Stock and gave him the Carmelite scapular, which we know as the brown scapular, Pope John the 22nd declared that Our Lady appeared to him and urgently recommended the confraternity of the Carmelite order. She had asked the Pope to ratify, as Christ's vicar on earth, the indulgences that our Lord had already granted in heaven for members of the Carmelite order who died wearing its scapular. These were plenary indulgences for the members of the Carmelite order and a partial indulgence for the members of his confraternity. The Blessed Mother would then affirm that she would descend from heaven to purgatory on the Saturday after their deaths and liberate and conduct to heaven all who were in purgatory who had earned this privilege. From this promise of being freed from purgatory on the following Saturday comes its name, Sabbatine Privilege, since Saturday in Latin is Sabbatum. Pope John the 22nd wrote at the end of the bull, quote, "This holy indulgence I therefore accept, I confirm and ratify it on earth, just as Jesus Christ has graciously granted it in heaven, on account of the merits of the Virgin Mary." The Sabbatine Privilege was also approved and confirmed by 16 popes, and this would include Pope St. Pius V. who gave us the traditional Latin Mass forever, dogmatically. Pope Paul V, in the year 1613, gave a very clear, maybe the clearest explanation of the assistance promised to souls in purgatory who fulfill the 17th privilege of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. And he said, quote, "It is lawful for the Carmelite fathers to preach that Catholics may piously believe in the help promised to the souls of the brethren and members of the confraternity of the Blessed Virgin of Mount Carmel, namely, that the Blessed Virgin will assist by her continual intercession, suffrages, and merits, and also by her special protection, particularly on the Saturday after death, which day has been consecrated to her by the Church, the souls of the brothers and the members of the confraternity departing this life in charity, who shall have worn the habit, scapular, and shall have observed chastity according to their particular state of life, and also have recited the little office, or, if unable to read, have kept the fast of the Church, and have abstained from the use of meat on Wednesdays and Saturdays, unless the feast of the Nativity of our Divine Lord should fall on one of those days." End quote. Pope Benedict XIV declared that the faithful should rely on the 17 privilege, and that neither the original bull nor the apparition of the Blessed Mother could be contested. And that is from Opera Omnia, dated 1767. So this is a dogma of the faith, and I'm going to go into more detail here as well before I head back to what the conditions are for the 17 privilege, because this is something that in New Church, in the Novus Ordo, is basically completely forgotten. They think everyone goes straight to heaven, unless of course you're a traditional Catholic like me. But you know, if you're a Muslim or a Protestant or schismatic Orthodox, atheist, sodomite, no problem. But I digress. So let's go to the dogmatic teaching on purgatory. So the Church puts forth two truths that are clearly defined as dogmas of the faith. The first is that there is a purgatory. The second is that the souls that are in purgatory may be assisted by the sufferings of the faithful, or the suffrage of the faithful, especially by the holy sacrifice of the Mass. That would be the traditional Latin Mass. So in response to the Protestant Revolution, the Protestant heretics, the Council of Trent reaffirmed this existence of purgatory that was already first taught, was taught at the First Council of Lyon. And here we go. So this is session 255. This was in 1563, the Decree on Purgatory. Quote, "Since the Church, instructed by the Holy Ghost, has taught in sacred councils, and very recently in this ecumenical council, following the sacred writings and the ancient tradition of the fathers, that there is a purgatory, and that the souls there detained are aided by the suffrages of the faithful, and chiefly by the acceptable sacrifice of the altar, the Holy Council commands the bishops that they strive diligently so that the sound doctrine of purgatory transmitted by the fathers and sacred councils be believed and maintained by the faithful of Christ and be everywhere taught and preached." Session 6, Canon 30. "If anyone says that after receiving the grace of justification, sacrament of penance, the guilt is fully remitted, and the debt of eternal punishment is so blotted out to every repentant sinner that no debt of temporal punishment remains to be discharged, either in this world or in purgatory, before the gates of heaven can be opened, let him be anathema." Session 14, Canon 12. "If anyone says that God always pardons the whole penalty together with the guilt, and that the satisfaction for sin made by penitence is nothing but the faith by which they perceive that Christ is satisfied for them, let him be anathema." Canon 13. "If anyone says that satisfaction for sins as to their temporal punishment is in no way made to God through the merits of Christ by the punishments inflicted by him and patiently borne, or by those penances imposed by the priest, or even those voluntarily undertaken, such as fasts, prayers, almsgiving, or other works of piety, and that, therefore, the best penance is merely a new life, let him be anathema. Canon 14. If anyone says that the satisfactions by which penitents atone for their sins through Christ are not a worship of God, but traditions of men, which obscure the doctrine of grace and the true worship of God, and the benefit itself of the death of Christ, let him be anathema. So it's clear here that the existence of purgatory is a dogma of the Catholic Church, and anyone who denies it is outside the Church. They cannot call themselves Catholics. Now let's move to the conditions of the Sabbatine privilege. So many people just assume that if you die wearing the brown scapular, you'll go to purgatory and then be liberated by Our Lady on the first Saturday after your death. But that is not the case. So this, as we read earlier, the Sabbatine privilege clearly states that the early liberation from purgatory applies only to those who wear the scapular and fulfill the other conditions. So there's three conditions. The first is wearing the brown scapular of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. You have to be officially enrolled in the scapular, and that official reception is made by a priest, a validly ordained priest, who places the scapular on the person and then recites a particular prayer that needs to be done only once in a person's life. In the past, before the Second Vatican Council, that was, I think, ordinarily done with First Holy Communion, if I'm not mistaken. The second condition is you have to live a life of chastity according to your state in life. The third is the daily recitation of the Little Office of the Blessed Virgin. So that's the Psalms. There is a special little office similar to the Divine Office that the clergy would pray, but obviously it's smaller, it's condensed. Instead of reciting the Little Office of the Blessed Virgin, it was stated before that persons who can't read should observe all the fasts observed by the Catholic Church and then also abstain from meat on all Wednesdays and Saturdays each year, except if Christmas falls on one of those days. And the faculty to change this condition to gain the privilege was granted to all confessors by Pope Leo XIII in the decree of the Congregation of Indulgences, June 1901. According to that decree, any priest with the diocesan faculties may commute the recitation of the Little Office to some other pious work, which would ordinarily be the daily recitation of the 15 decades of the Holy Rosary. So most lay people just ask the priest to approve this substitution. But it's very easy today to obtain the Little Office of the Blessed Virgin. You could buy it online and pray that. Because obviously today the Novus Ordo priests, I mean, most of them are not even validly ordained, and or at best there's doubt. We can't approach doubtful sacraments or doubtful clerics, but especially, I mean, they're modernists. They've unfortunately been taught modernism, and that's why you have a new rite of mass, you have a new canonization process, you have a new theology, you have a new calendar. Everything is new. Why? It's a new religion, and they're showing it, telling it to you in your face. Unfortunately, most people can't see through that. But let's continue here. Now on to Pope St. Gregory and the 30 Gregorian Masses. So, similar to the Sabbatine privilege, the 30 Gregorian Masses apply to the release of the souls in purgatory through the assistance of Our Lady. The practice of these Masses was founded by Pope St. Gregory the Great in 590 AD in St. Andrew's Monastery in Rome. So he had established that 30 Masses offered on 30 consecutive days without interruption release a specific soul from purgatory. And remember, it was Pope St. Gregory the Great that gave us the Gregorian sacramentary, which is essentially the Mass, the way it was always said and became known today as what we call the Tridentine Mass or the Latin Mass, the true Catholic Mass of the Roman Rite. And this is also further proven in Pope St. Pius V's papal document, Quo Primum, which said that the missal that he was publishing went back to the earliest fathers. So that is the true Mass. It is not the extraordinary form, as some liberals would like to say. It is the ordinary form. It is the tradition of the Church. The Novus Ordo is just that. It is new. It is Protestant. It was created by 6 Protestant ministers. Look it up. It's documented. And you can see, if you look at the new Mass versus any of the Protestant worship supper services, it's essentially the same thing. So it's not a Catholic rite. And, you know, good luck trying to find a Novus Ordo priest to say 30 Gregorian Masses. They wouldn't know what they're doing. They wouldn't probably even believe in it. And how would you know if they're validly ordained? And this goes for the Society of St. Peter, too. Those clergy of the Society of St. Peter are ordained by modernist bishops. They betrayed Archbishop Lefebvre. They signed an agreement with Rome. They accept the new Mass. They accept the false doctrines, the modernist heretical doctrines of Vatican II. So sadly, they're modernist wolves in traditional clothing. And that's the key you have to understand. Just saying a Latin Mass doesn't mean you're traditional. It's about the faith. And if you go back in history, if you go back even to the French Revolution, there were priests that signed an agreement with the Masonic government. And there were saints, there were Catholic people that would refuse to go to those Masses, would not be ordained by those bishops, because those priests compromised on the faith. And that is what the same thing that the Fraternity of St. Peter did. That's what the Society of St. Pius X has done with the doctrinal agreement that they did sign with Rome, although most people don't even realize it. But that's why the bishops back in 2012 had a letter that was made public about what was going on. And so now they're under Rome, their marriages, their sacraments, all of that. That's why you'll probably never see a new bishop in the Society of St. Pius X unless that bishop is consecrated by a modernist Novus Ordo, you know, invalid, at best doubtfully valid, heretical bishop. And for any of you who doubt what I'm saying, go read past issues of the Recusant. It's the SSPX Marian Corps publication. Go ask Father Hugo, listen to some of his sermons. It's all there. It's all in writing. It's all in black and white. There's nothing that is not true, but many things are hidden because certain people don't want you to know this. But it's the faith. It's the faith that matters. It's the doctrine of the faith that matters. It's the Mass and the faith that matters. Just having a Latin Mass doesn't mean you have the faith, and people need to get this in their head. And now let's go to the final part, and that would be the location of purgatory and getting help from the poor souls. So the faith really reveals nothing definitively about where purgatory actually is. The most common opinion that's held by theologians and that most agrees with sacred scriptures is that purgatory is in the bowels of the earth, not far from hell. And St. Robert Bellarmine, he concurs with this in his own catechism. Now, the words that we say in the Apostles' Creed, "he descended into hell," actually, in Latin, you know, it comes up as inferos. But in the catechism of the Council of Trent, it signifies the inferior or the lower places where the souls who have not reached heaven are detained. So it's not that he went into the hell of the damned, you know, hell being, you know, the absence of God or the suffering in purgatory in this case. So the three inferior places are limbo, purgatory, and then the hell of the reprobates, which You've also heard our Lord call Gehenna. So it's Gehenna where the damned are tormented forever by the devils and by fire and by stench and just all sorts of horror. Purgatory is another place where the souls who have been saved suffer a physical fire to atone for, to expiate for all their sins. And that way they'll be entirely purified before they can enter into the blessedness of heaven, the beatific vision. The third lower place, which is the limbo of the patriarchs, also called the limbo of the fathers, that's where the souls of the saints who died before the coming of Christ were received. And so they were waiting there for Christ to descend. And then in the scriptures, we know Christ preached the gospel to the souls, in the limbo of the fathers, and then brought them up into heaven. And then, of course, we know there's the limbo of the unbaptized infants. And this is a place of natural happiness, but they can never go into the beatific vision because they have original sin on their souls. So that is just part of the justice of God and the punishment to mankind for original sin. And if you're not baptized either by water, by blood, or by desire, and those are limited things that actually the church does teach, the threefold baptism in the catechism of the Council of Trent and in the Catechism of St. Pius X. And you can read it in the Martyrology as well. So just go back to the limbo of the fathers, the patriarchs of the Old Testament. In that limbo, they did enjoy peace, consolation. And then when our Lord said to the good thief Dismas, that this day thou shalt be with me in paradise, that's where they went. They went into the limbo of the fathers, of the patriarchs of the Old Testament, and it was paradise. It was in heaven. It was paradise at the Garden of Eden, right? No sin, no suffering, no sorrow. They just longed for the redemption of our Lord. They were exempt from pain in that limbo. And then, just to clarify on the limbo of unbaptized infants, the Catholic Encyclopedia states that that's where the souls of infants and others who die without grievous sin or personal guilt are detained. They are excluded from the beatific vision because of original sin, because it has not been removed from their souls. But they suffer no pain and enjoy a perfect natural happiness. St. Thomas Aquinas and other doctors of the church state that divine justice does permit certain souls in purgatory to appear to instruct us here on this earth or to procure aid or suffrages for their souls. And you heard Father Hugo talk about that in that wonderful sermon we listened to just before. So that would be, in some instances, the ghosts that people talk about. In other instances, they're demons. That's why you need holy water, you need sacramentals, you need to pray every day, and you need to keep your soul in a state of grace. And just one more thing on the location of purgatory. Let's remember that in ancient times, they didn't know what was in the center of the earth, and we know now that it is fire. So, it just proves the doctrines of the church that hell, purgatory, the fires inside the actual earth are there. And there's no reason not to believe that souls can inhabit, devils can inhabit the center of the earth. Now, obviously, it is of utmost importance to help the poor souls. Again, we heard in that great sermon from Father Hugo detail about that. But just to stress a little bit more, St. Augustine states that one of the holiest works, one of the best exercises of piety that we can practice in this world is to offer sacrifices, alms, and prayers for the dead. St. Jerome states that the relief which we procure for the departed obtains for us a similar mercy. St. Francis de Sales said, "To assist the souls in purgatory is to perform the most excellent of the works of mercy, or rather it is to practice in a most sublime manner all the works of mercy together. It is to visit the sick. It is to give drink to those who thirst for the vision of God. It is to feed the hungry, to ransom prisoners, to clothe the naked, to procure for poor exiles the hospitality of the heavenly Jerusalem. It is to comfort the afflicted, to instruct the ignorant, in short, to practice all the works of mercy in one. So, please, November 2nd is All Souls Day. Let's especially remember them that day. But let's pray for the poor souls in purgatory each and every day, every morning, every evening. Name your deceased relatives, friends, priests that have passed away, popes in the past that have passed away, archbishops, cardinals, those who have not been declared saints by the traditional church. Let's remember them in our prayers as well. They will pray for us. And so, with that, I hope you've learned from this. Please remember to hit the like and subscribe buttons, and please keep in your prayers.